Hello guys, my name is Bhargav, CEO and founder of Tailwinds.ai. In this talk, I'm going to talk about SLOs that I did for Kubernetes as part of my consulting gig at various organizations. The different types of organizations, they had different types of deployments. I would put from my consulting opportunities at three different dimensions to SLO. One is the type of deployment. You can have an on-prem deployment where you would own your master resources and the worker nodes and the infrastructure like compute, network, and storage. Then you have the other side is the cloud deployments where you go to the cloud. Typically you would have the managed services that you would take and you typically manage only the worker nodes, the Kubernetes platform. That's one dimension. Then the second dimension is the kind of team that you are. Depends on the SLO that you're looking at. If you are an SRE, you would manage the infrastructure plus the cloud platform. That's what typically are founded. You would do one type of SLOs. If you're a dev team, right, dev or DevOps, you would typically look at the workloads or the applications and you will do one type of SLOs. And also the intent also matters. Hey, am I doing it for availability purpose or reliability? Or I'm just doing it for an alarm reduction. I'll tell you about an interesting case of how SLO was used in an alarm reduction case. So I would put majorly, these two categories. One is platform SLOs and the application SLOs. In the platform SLOs, typically they are divided into two parts. One is the infrastructure, such as your network, compute, and storage. And you would probably want to know, hey, what is the latency in the network? What is the SLO should I have from the network team or from the storage? How quickly you want to spin up a disk or how quickly your compute works, right? So these are the type of SLOs you would probably have at the infrastructure level. When you go to the platform level, typically the Kubernetes, so you start depending on what type of Kubernetes are you using, right? If you're in charge of your master, you start looking at your master components. Or also you look at the stack shared components. For example, database is one thing that is shared among many different teams. So you want to, have that SLO part of the platform SLO or the Kubernetes SLO team, right, the SRE team. Then there is the application team, which actually looks at different kinds of SLO. They look at availability SLO. What is the health of my pod, right? If I have three instances running, how available are they? Then I want to also look at the pod lifecycle SLOs, right? If I want to quickly create a pod, how long does it take to start up a pod, right? So this really is necessary if you're if you're in a large scale deployments, and also in cases where you do autoscaler. Autoscaler involves two types: the cluster autoscaler and pod autoscaler. The pod startup typically dependent on how quickly the pod comes up. The cluster, you bring up one more node, so the dependency has in which type of cloud you are or what kind of distribution you have and how it is supporting the cluster autoscaler. Then of course your end-to-end latency and also the reliability, number of successful requests, etc. And all that comes into the picture when you start looking at the application SLO. Obviously, we are not looking at all of the SLOs. We are looking at few factors that we have done, that I have done as part of my consulting opportunities. So let's take a typical case of pod startup SLO, right? So this is typically of interest to both, largely to application team, and less relative, I would put SRE team, right? The goal of SRE is to make sure the pod startup happens in the contract that they have. So this is of interest to large deployments, as the new applications keep coming on, they keep changing, modifying, deleted. So how quickly you can, the life cycle is there. And of course, we talked about the autoscaler. For a pod autoscaler, you need to have this SLO. When this is not of interest, I've been in deployments where the customer have deployed in a very static way. They don't keep changing their services often. So in those cases, this SLO does not really matter at all, right? So if you look at the pod startup components, there are many components that are involved, right? Now, there are many bridges to jump to actually get to the pod startup. So the SRE team or the platform team would be interested in the SLO of the, each of the components. But whereas the application team only looks at it, hey, how quickly the pod comes up. Right, you know, so aggregate of aggregate of each of the component, right? So the SRE team goes and starts monitoring in each of the components in the picture that you see, and typically the third party and network dependencies are ignored. For example, you know, Kubelet, it tries to download an image. The image size could be in gigs, so you know we can't really give an SLO for that. It's an application's headache, or you know you have the network latency there, or DNS, and many things there. You know, so that is generally typically ignored. But that SLO we are looking at is, hey, you know, I do a create, and from then on, how quickly the Kubelet starts to download that image, right? You know, that's the SLO. So if you look at it, the SLO that we did for certain customers, they say in a very steady state, you want the pod to come up in less than 5 seconds, about 99% of the times over a day, right? So cluster scaler depends on, again, the kind of distribution or the managed services that you have. So there is a dependency on the underlying infrastructure there. So you kind of put a text depending on the kind of infrastructure that you have. Of course, pod scaler, if you do a pod scaler, it is as good as bringing up a new pod. So, you know, again, it's less than 5 seconds. So again, if you look at these stateful pods, it also depends on underlying storage that you have. So again, it depends on the managed services or the infrastructure that you have. And we don't do this stateful pods often. So we kind of keep it at a day or a week rather than seconds, right? So this is what we did for a few customers for a pod startup. And this is an interesting SLO we did for one of the customers, right? So if you look, their deployments is pretty small. So they have one cluster per customer, and in each cluster, they have the same set of 15 services, which pretty much don't change over a period of time. So this customer, had a small deployment, and they would either onboard this cluster in customer's VPC, or they have it in their own VPC, depending upon whatever agreement the customer and their customer have it. Right. So they had a limited DevOps team. So they they had about 10 customers. So what they did was, hey, I don't want to react to all the changes that is happening in each of the cluster. So I want to only react when something really goes bad. You know, I have a limited DevOps team, and you know, I have 10 customers. So what they said was, okay, for all the services, I will have two instances running. So if one instance is down, I'm pretty much okay. But if both instances are down, I'm going to go in and take an action. The DevOps team, which is there, will go and take an action. So kind of gives a breathing space for our DevOps team. What happened quickly was the number of customers grew from 10 to 50 within a span of about a year. But while the DevOps team, they could not scale the DevOps team pretty much. So what they said was, hey, now that I have a challenge of scaling the DevOps team, but I'm reacting more faster to the problems that exist in customer clusters. So I want a different mechanism to react slower. So what they did was, hey, I'll add for 50 customers, I'll increase the number of instances to 3 and react slower than necessary, right? So that I don't want to suck up the DevOps team time to keep fixing the same problems again and again, the toils again and again. So very interesting way of doing this SLO to reduce the alarms. But again, if you look at it, it is a real business challenge that they have, that they try to solve using this SLO. Then other type of SLO, more of an infrastructure where SLO or The SRE team who will be of interest is the DNS SLO, right? So DNS runs actually as part of your cluster, be it managed services or on-prem or you running your own cluster. So basically, there is a DNS, QBDNS running in KubeSystem namespace. The way it works is, hey, when a client wants to talk to a service inside or external to the cluster, it does a DNS request and then gets the required IP to talk to the service. So that's the whole DNS. So how quickly you can discover the clients is one of the SLOs, right? And for any new services, how quickly DNS learns them is another SLO. But from my experience, based on the consulting I have done, what happened was people have only looked at the DNS response. They want the response to be in a very short period of time, in a short period of time. So they had an SLO for that. In few cases, they have done because the SLOs was not consistent. I mean, they were, the DNS was taking longer than what it was. They had to go in and optimize in few cases to fix the problem. Another SLOs, right? A DNS is a more an infrastructure SLO. There are other SLOs you can, admission control, webhooks, API server, load balancer. You can start looking at the reliability and availability of these of the systems and start fixing them over a period of time. Yeah. So, the few ones which I've shared are from a pod. It's an application-based SLO. Then the SLO was more from a business angle. And the third SLO was an infrastructure SLO, kind of, split into three different types. Thank you, guys. If you have any questions, you can always reach out to me, bhargav@tailwinds.ai or bbikaj in Twitter. Thank you very much.